I decided to go back down to Louisiana and look at the offshore supply vessels in more detail, and I will share those videos with you shortly. But the reason that I wanted to go back was because of working with clients and designers on allocating space in these halls for the conversion. And I felt like we needed to really understand better which systems we wanted to keep, which ones we wanted to take out, and how to best utilize these vessels. So typically, you have an existing deckhouse here in bridge on the commercial vessel, and you have your crew quarters, and you have your galley, you have HVAC systems, you have waste systems, you have walk-in fridge and freezers. That represents all systems and indeed some of the space usage that you're gonna want in your expedition yacht. And so the smart thing to do is keep as much of that as possible, if not all of it, and then incorporate what you want for your expedition yacht as additional accommodations. Going aft here, we're gonna look at these spaces in the next slides, but of course it's all open space to be built on in the expedition conversion. And it's pretty much plug and play. I mean, this can be a touch and go helipad here, or this can be a commercially certified helipad with refueling and a hangar with a lift going down. Underneath here can be a dive center, it can be all sorts of things, and we'll get into that. And on almost all of these vessels, you want to have a variety of tenders and toys for different weather conditions and different places that you go on your expeditions. And you can swap out, you know, here's a tender here that's utilitarian and probably operates very well in Arctic climates. And then you've got open vessels that you may not want to take to the Arctic. A lot of people refer to these as pickup trucks, but this is a pickup truck with a huge basement. So obviously you've got the engine room down there, but you've also got space once you remove the mud tanks where you can put a cinema, you can put a tender garage with a side opening. That is incredibly useful space. So the nice thing about these vast aft decks, aside from the nice clean open space, is that they are heavy load bearing. And a very important thing about these offshore commercial vessels is that they're very beamy. You've got 56 feet or 17 meters of beam here. So for the purpose of our discussion here, we're looking at a 220 foot hull. The 240 foot and the 260 foot are basically the same configuration on the bow, and it's an extension added to the stern. And that gives you not only deck space that you can use for all sorts of things, but it also gives you volume in the hull. And so right under the main deck amidships are these giant dry bulk tanks that we're gonna rip out, along with all the piping and pumps associated with them. And that opens up basically two decks of open space under the main deck. And for comparison purposes, here's a typical 67 meter motor yacht. And you see here that a typical European white yacht is 33 feet or 11 meters in beam. And that is a huge difference in terms of the volume. You'll also notice that on the yacht, the bow is narrow, and so it won't support much weight. So what they do is they put a little lounge area up here, which is pretty much useless unless you're going about 5 knots in a calm sea puttering around a beach, not where expedition yachts are going. So in an expedition conversion of a commercial vessel, we're gonna make maximum use of this bow area as useful space for the ship. I would contend that if you're at sea and you have the urge to swim, you might just jump in the ocean instead of using this valuable stern space for a swimming pool. There's a myriad of possibilities of what you can do with the broad aft deck on these conversions. But if you still wish to have a swimming pool, you'll see that there's one here under the helipad. And the other thing I would say is that there is a lot of deck space. That's great deck space. If you want to sunbathe all day, it's great to have that. But the actual housing block, that interior space, we can achieve the same interior space on the bow of our conversion, again, because of the beam. We're not going to press that far back into the hull. And if you did want to press that far back into the hull, and you wanted to have much more in the way of toys and much more in the way of space back here, you just get a longer haul. It's going to basically have the same engines. It's going to consume pretty much the same amount of fuel and require the same amount of crew in the longer haul, because your basic ship system on the bow is going to be the same from 220 to 240 to 260. So now I'd like to jump into some new video footage that I took of offshore supply vessels in Louisiana, where I went back specifically to look at the spaces and at the conversion process of these larger offshore supply vessels. Today I'm inside of what is probably the largest shed that I've ever seen in Fourchon, Louisiana. About to go aboard this vessel behind me here, 240 foot OSV. This hull is almost 25 years old, and these rugged steel hulls hold up extremely well, and you won't see much difference in this hull when compared with a hull on a vessel that's maybe 8 or 10 years old. Existing deckhouse can be enhanced with big side decks and foredecks going around with larger ports and big glass. So typically you build your guest accommodations out on the main deck and then put the dining salon and the different guest areas on the deck above, and then finally the owner's deck, which would be three decks up from the main deck. All of that can be fabricated off-site in a shed and then laid onto the hull. And of course, how you do this is entirely up to you and your naval architect. We managed to get aboard just before a passing thunderstorm, doused the decks, and actually helped cool things off a little bit. We were fortunate to be able to get aboard this vessel as the crew was just finishing up preparations and setting off for the Gulf of Mexico. These bridges are fairly vast compared to yacht standards. You also immediately notice that you have a 360 degree vantage point. And all these vessels are equipped with very robust DP2 systems and all of the class required redundancies. Walking aft to starboard, you have your tank management and all the pump systems, and then the alarms and the fire systems. And despite everything being digital these days, you would still have on all these vessels full sets of manuals. And on the aft side of the bridge is the command station for all of the operations when out at the rig, with the redundant DP2 system and full control of the vessel and tremendous view of the workspace from this aft side of the bridge. There's a nice big nav station here, which has all of the normal digital input and data points coming in that you would expect, and then a really nice traditional sized chart table here with all of the chart drawers for the printed charts. And you can see that they are using these in addition to all of the GPS and the digital readouts that they get. I wanted to make note here, although these are U.S. built Cat engine vessels, you'll see Ulstein equipment here and Rolls-Royce. Both those suppliers are in Norway. And on top of that, the interiors that we're going to inspect now were fabricated in Norway as well. For an expedition yacht conversion, these facilities are turnkey and ready to go to sea. Temperatures in the 90s, where I wanted to be was here in the cold stores, and even better in the large walk-in freezer compartment, which was chock full for the trip. Here's a typical cabin. It's actually a spare cabin because they're using it for storage right now, but this gives you an idea. The engine room is vast, with at least two decks of height and equipment on all two decks. There's a mezzanine level here. You have Caterpillar mains and Caterpillar generators. There's a full inventory of spares on board and of course workshops. Power management is in the engineering space, which is up high, affording a view of the entire engine room space. I just wanted to jump back out of the tour for a moment here and look at a general arrangement of a typical OSV. This is not the vessel that we're on right now, but it's a typical layout. In this case, the engine room is all the way aft, which is ideal because it isolates your noise, vibration, and exhaust away from the general living quarters. So realize that on the bridge and the crew accommodations that we've been looking at, we're basically looking at the front 15 or 20% of the hull. That whole world is there in the conversion, ready to go. So what we're gonna walk through right now, I just wanted to point out, this is probably about 100 feet of the interior space in the hull where you've got your dry bulk tanks and your liquid mud tanks. And this is all available to be repurposed. So you can extend the crew areas in here. You can put in crew gyms, you can put in a cinema. You've got all kinds of storage. You can have walk-in reefers. Back here is typically on an expedition yacht, it's gonna be part of your garage and your water toys. And so that's the space here. And what I think when I'm talking with clients, something that they don't realize if they're used to 160 foot or 180 foot yacht hulls, where they're trying very hard to find space to put things, they don't realize the incredible open spaces that exist here that we can repurpose. And that is a one of the huge advantages of these offshore supply vessels. So let's go back on board and check it out. So here are your wire runs out in the open, of course, and these are the liquid mud tanks. So they are taking up a space that is probably more than two decks height-wise. And you'll see as we walk along here, the pumping station in the at the center of the hull here. And these are all the liquid mud pumps and piping. All that's going to come out, and it's going to become usable space for our expedition yacht purposes. A glimpse at the independent Ulstein Rolls-Royce Z-drives, which function as part of the DP2 system of the vessel. So as mentioned at the outset of the video, the task at hand in the conversion is to retain the valuable assets of this hull and the systems that are already on board, and to end up with a wonderful global expedition yacht.